Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Like never before, oh my soul, worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Come, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Your holy name. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm Uncle Orv, Reverend Orville James, one of the four Reverend James that will be involved today. I get to go first. So welcome to all of you and thank you for being here. Many funerals are hard, really hard sometimes, aren't they? Here's something that speaks to that. Listen, if you haven't already, you will lose someone you can't live without. And your heart will be badly broken. And the bad news is you never completely get over the loss of a beloved companion. But this is also the good news. They live in your wounded heart. And you come through. It's like having a broken leg after it heals that still hurts when the weather's cold, but you learn to dance with the limp. That is true for so many, isn't it? And I guess our attitude has an important role to play. We allow grief. We never live in denial. While at the same time, we take a positive forward stance and with the occasional glance of gratitude backward, we keep looking forward. I like what the British journalist Malcolm Muggeridge, some of you would know that name, I like what he wrote. It's not true that when friends or loved ones die, one is cut off from them, he said. Relations based on love and friendship may actually become closer after death, and one goes on communicating, not through mediums or spiritualism or any such rubbish, this is Muggeridge, but by a common communion of spirit which grows deeper. The Creed talks about the communion of saints. I think that's what Muggeridge is talking about. The communion of spirit which grows deeper and more expressive as one moves toward the close of one's own life. I'm going to come back to that a little later. But it's so true. Even in loss, we are comforted, we carry hope, and we smile at all the beauty and joy and fun in life. Which triggers one more quote, and I'm hoping we can throw this one on the screen now. Brilliant. Thank you. Read this and tell me you don't think of Ruth when you read this. May you see the goodness of God in your actual days. May you be given wisdom and joy and something worth grieving when it's gone. May the steady and abiding presence of God be with you at night when everyone goes home. May the fire reveal who you have always been. And then may you rise from the ashes with a grin, a wild heart that won't be talked out of love and possibility. I'm going to choke up regularly. Let's put that now. But I love that quote. May you rise from the ashes with a grin, a wild heart that won't be talked out of love and possibility. Amen to that. Let me bow and pray as we gather our spirits. Great God of the universe, we welcome you this afternoon. We acknowledge to you that this is hard. We accept that we're going to have tears and a lump in the throat. We are going to grieve. And we are going to celebrate and give thanks. Our tears are okay. If you will send your Holy Spirit, let your Spirit sweep in and sweep through and lay bless upon us and give us comfort and fill us with affection and gratitude. And then let us walk out of here with confidence and with hope. In the name of Jesus, the risen Christ, amen and amen. Before we even start, I want to say thanks to this music team. I know what you're going to do for us. And I just want to let you know the music that they're playing and that Nancy's going to introduce us to and lead, all chosen by Ruth. And I'll phrase it this way. She wants us to sing with gusto. All right? We're in this. Thanks, Nancy.
And that was exactly what I was going to say to lead in. Ruth wanted us to sing with all our hearts. If you're not familiar with the music, listen to it and let the words run over your spirit. The hope that is in it is a part of what Ruth chose. And if you can sing, sing out and sing with gusto. So would you please stand as we sing, Christ the Lord is risen today, an Easter hymn for a risen people.
with our old faith ancestors. We now recite together the word from Psalm number 121. I lift my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. Amen.
I want to share a couple of family memories, and I want to say thanks. You sound really good if you have good writers. Well, Adam and Barb wrote what I'm about to share. As we think about Ruthie and what she's done in her life, what she has achieved, what she has endured, who she has been, just listen, maybe shut your eyes at times and picture her. Ruth, Goose, Gosling, and Auntie Ruth. I called her by all those names at various points in our lives together, as well as a couple more when I was ticked off at her as a child for something. Adam didn't actually write ticked off, but just throw you under the bus right there. I was ticked off at her as a child for something that in all likelihood was my fault. You got that right. As many of you know, my sister was the kindest human being I've ever met, and I'll likely not ever meet her equal. Therefore, whatever I was upset about as an 8-year-old boy was most definitely my fault, as she's the kinder of the two of us by a large margin. Kind. I can't reiterate that word enough. I'm told I do not have an infinite amount of time to speak about her today. Therefore, I want that word to resonate with all of you. Ruth was the definition of kindness. Always thinking of others, myself included, ahead of herself, and fiercely loyal to those she loved. My sister loved me. And he bold, capitalized, underlined that. You can check my notes later. My sister loved me with her whole heart. She was there for me in moments that no one on this earth except her and I know about. My sister was my best friend. She knew everything about me, all my faults, all the actions I've done in my life that I regret, and all the things I've said in my life that I wish I could take back. And yet, she never judged or condemned me. She simply listened, offered her words of wisdom, and always a kind solution to my life's problems. She did this in the face of living day to day with one of life's greatest problems, a physical body that didn't operate as it should. Ruth lived with an illness for an exceptionally long time. Physically, it wore her down year after year. However, her human spirit remained incredibly unchanged. Her emotional and mental health was quite simply remarkable. She lived the fullest life a person with physical limitations could live. She was always quick-witted, happy, supportive, and most of all, kind to everyone in her life, not just family and friends, everyone. I'll miss so much about Ruth in the days, weeks, months, and years ahead. She'll always be on my mind. In precious moments in her niece's lives, that I know she would enjoy with a huge smile. In cherished time at Bob's Lake, family dinners, birthdays, every holiday, where just being together is all any of us really want, and some have known as homemade pie. And he finished with this paragraph, Auntie Ruth, what I call you today, I am glad you are no longer carrying the burden of the insurmountable amount of physical pain you had to endure another day. I'm grateful for a peaceful passing in the final days. I love you. And he capitalized in bold and underlined that. I love you with my whole heart. I did yesterday, I do today, and I will forever. Your brother, your friend, AJ. Thank you, Adam. You let all of us come into your heart's experience. Thank you. So this one's from Barb. On behalf of myself and my family, thank you, everyone, for coming today to celebrate and mourn Ruth with us. You honor her with the blessing of your presence, and you comfort her family. I'd like to tell you some things you might like to know about Ruth to really appreciate the wonderful soul she is. The puzzle pieces that fit together to become Ruth were varied and interesting. Ruth loved freezies, rainy days, the Saskatchewan Rough Riders. She hated barbecued spare ribs, black licorice, and the New England Patriots. She loved Shakespeare's King Lear and Richard III, the poetry of John Keats and Archibald Lampman. She named her cat after Canadian poet Bliss Carman. I wondered where Bliss got. There it is, okay. But she also loved Anne of Green Gables and Harry Potter. Every night she listened to Handel's Water Music as she was falling asleep, but also declared she could die a happy woman because she heard Bob Seger sing old-time rock and roll live and in concert. We loved the fascinating mixture of things that created our daughter, our sibling, niece, cousin, and friend. Here it comes again. Ruth's essence was kindness. Her compassionate heart automatically reached out and cared for others. She looked for reasons that might have made others ornery and extended grace readily, but she would not tolerate injustice and spoke up against oppression in any form, and she was intensely loyal. She adored her nieces. They lit up her life. Hours of playing Mexican train. I don't know that one. You'll have to teach me. And doing crafts with them are wonderful memories to savor. Family and friends were her priority, and she made time and effort for both as much as lupus allowed her. We love her deeply. We cherish the treasure she is to all of us. It will be hard to live without her sparkles, her cheekiness, and pizzazz. Lupus is a cruel disease. It's a hungry predator that will not stop until satiated. A friend writes that Ruth was a warrior in this contest with lupus and an example of valor and personal diligence. But lupus failed to quench her buoyant spirit and her heart of gold. Despite her limitations, Ruth blessed others by being present to them, by intentionally connecting with people, by listening carefully for what was both said and unsaid. Another friend comments that now when things are tough, she finds herself asking, what would Ruth do? As her mom and caregiver, loving her with my whole heart, I watched the progress of her illness take many things from my beloved daughter, but she remained funny, feisty, sarcastic, often irreverent, usually silly, careful of others, and a sheer joy to live with. She was grateful for all her healthcare workers, even trying to thank them in the ER in Hamilton as she struggled to breathe. Our family doctor, Allison McTavish, was Ruth's best quarterback and friend. Words are poor currency with which to repay this wonderful doctor for her excellent care. Ruth's life verse was Jeremiah 29, verse 11. Some of you know this verse. Listen again. For I know, this is the Lord speaking to Jeremiah, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. A wise friend said recently, when God decides to bring someone home, nothing can prevent it. The God who is sure and dependable has followed through on that promise. Ruth's hope is realized and her future secure in God's presence. God's mercy is generous and it is as wide as the sea. To which I want to add, amen. Amen. Thank you, Barb.
Good afternoon. My name is Nancy Robinson. And Ruth was my friend. I had a really hard time sitting down to write this because, like so many of you, the last time I saw Ruth, she was so very much alive. I didn't know when I bent down to drop a kiss on the top of her head after celebrating her dad's birthday with her family that I would not see her again. She had laughed with me and tossed me the other container of blue cheese dip because we both liked to tuck our pizza crusts in it. She'd cuddled up on the couch with her precious nieces, and we'd fretted that as Daisy chased her Kong around the crowded family room that she was cutting off Ruth's oxygen as she trampled on the cord. I'm sure there was some witty and caustic banter about somebody's outrageous comments on Twitter as well. She was tired, for sure, but she was her feisty, funny, thoughtful, kind, and beautiful self that evening. And as I've read comments and texted and messaged with many of you, shared tearful moments, greeted you at the visitation last night, I have heard the same thing over and over many times. I didn't know she was so sick. We knew some, of course. Over the course of her illness, there were numerous times it was touch and go. But fabulous medical staff, the mercies of our God, and Ruth's fierce and indomitable spirit allowed us to build more memories. And in the in-between times, Ruth lived her life. Ruth lived her life. She laughed with us, watched movies and football and TV with us, ate dinner with us and our kids. Even if each item of food on the plate was carefully separated so that it didn't touch, she gasped and she wondered at the beautiful things around her, and she raged and ranted about the injustices and stupidity around us. She carried on interesting and deep and get to the real things kind of conversations. She asked questions and she listened and she saw us, as Barb mentioned. She blessed us with thoughtful gifts and messages and visits. She thought about us and encouraged us to try new things. And she challenged us sometimes. And even in the midst of her own struggles and pain, she prayed for us. I am a part of a text thread where we share prayer requests quite often, and almost without fail, Ruth was the first one to chime in. So how could someone who was so fully engaged in living have been so sick and close to death? I'm sure you can hear her voice say it. You could probably say it with me. I know, right? Right? How can she be gone? Right? But here's the thing. There was a Ruth before the illness. I first met Ruth when she was only 9 years old. She was the goofy little sister to her two older, cooler siblings. And I'll just carry on the roast a little bit. Adam thought he was cool. Sweet, bookish, loving. And then she was a teenager in the back of my car, enthusiastically belting out the Spice Girls all the way to Hilton Head Island. Kristen. A hardworking student, eager to grow in her faith and to lead, she spent summers at camp. A young woman among many dear friends, a university student, a volunteer in my middle school classroom where she loved on and encouraged the student in the class who most needed it. A loving teacher herself, a talented real estate agent, and a much loved and valued colleague and friend. And apparently a bull rider at Big Teskus and a pool shark. I didn't know that. Vibrant, loving, intelligent, faithful. And she managed to carry and refine these qualities throughout her illness. But here's the other thing. There is a Ruth after illness. While Ruth's heart and spirit could never be crushed, while she grew more and more beautiful and loving and insightful as she lived with lupus, her body let her down. Sooner than she had would have liked, and sooner than we would have liked. But Ruth is not her body. She lives on in what fills our hearts and memories, and in how her heart and spirit touched ours. And while we will certainly miss the sound of her laugh, the warmth of her embrace, the sight of the smile on her face and the glint in her eye, we have been imprinted by her life, and she is not lost to us. And she lives on. Her faith kept her hopeful, and she trusted in the promises of her God that her life was not limited to this earthly existence. There is a Ruth after illness. Have you heard the phrase, go big or go home? I think you'll agree that our jewelry-loving, sparkles and pink-wearing, rabid rider fan knew how to go big. And now, sweet Ruth, you have gone home. We have a tribute in pictures that we'll play in just a moment. And our worship band, that Ruth loved to hear, is going to sing underneath it. And we sang this at Easter a number of years ago, and Ruth was a part of a chorus of people who joined in at the bridge. And the bridge says this, I hear the voice of many angels sing. And I am thrilled to know that as we sing here, Ruth is singing too.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. day that's drawing near. When this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the cry of every longing heart, you are worthy, you are worthy, worthy is the Lamb.
I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God.
One of Ruth's other favorite hymns was a hymn called How Firm a Foundation, and it was tied to a scripture that she loved. She walked through many flames and many fires, but knew the presence of God in the middle of it and the foundation on which she was grounded. So Lynn's going to belt it out on the organ again. Would you please stand and sing with us?
What more can be? afternoon. I'm John's kid brother, Uncle Paul to Ruthie. Reading from John's Gospel, chapter 14, selected verses. Jesus, speaking to his followers, says in part of this, right during the Last Supper, just very shortly before his arrest, trial, and crucifixion. He said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way and where I am going." Thomas, one of the disciples, said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm coming for you. In a little while, the world will see me no more, but you will see me, because I live. You shall live also. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid."
In the end, Ruth's passing was quite peaceful. And one of her other favorite worship songs was one called "Bless the Lord, O My Soul." Well, she had many reasons, probably to curse. She chose instead to bless the Lord with all her heart. Most of the time, probably. I'm sure she had some cursing moments. But as her family sang this song with her, she slipped into God's presence just before the final verse. And Ruth had a hard time drawing a deep breath. Latterly. And I believe that as she slept, she drew a great big deep breath, the deepest breath she had drew in eons, and joined you in singing this last chorus. So let's stand. Let's stand and sing, "Bless the Lord, O My Soul."
Bless the Lord, O my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Sun comes up. Your song again, whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Amen.
that's the Lord, oh my soul.
Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending.
10,000 years and forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Thanks to the band, right? Amen, yeah. So we've had a chance to celebrate Ruthie. And just love her from a distance. Remember her with gratitude and affection. I want to take a couple of minutes now and broaden the focus. I want to think about all of us, not just Ruth's life, but our lives, our living, our experiences. And I want to start with a rhetorical question. You don't have to answer this out loud, but I want you to think about it. What were the most exciting 5 minutes of your life so far? Give it a think. What were the most breathtaking, exhilarating, emotion-producing 300 seconds you've experienced? Maybe some of you went bungee diving. Anybody go skydiving out of an airplane? Whitewater canoeing? I'm thinking of experiences that would leave you gasping with exhilaration. There's a good chance, if we were able to remember them, that the most exciting 5 minutes of your life were the first 5 minutes after you were born. Now think about this. Just try and go back in your imagination. You're 9 months in this darkness and isolation, and then you discover through a traumatic experience there's a whole world out there of colors and tastes and sounds and sights and other people. I think if you could have talked back then, you would have kind of looked around and said, "Mom, I had no idea. This is amazing. This is a way better arrangement to be out here." It's quite possible, right? The thing is, after those first exhilarating 5 minutes, there's been a lot of ups and downs, and there's been a lot of grind and weariness, right? I want to suggest something to you. I believe the most amazing 5 minutes you'll ever experience will be the first 5 minutes after you die. Give that a think. For centuries, the brightest minds on earth have devoted whole lifetimes to penetrate the mystery, the veil, and learn what lies on the other side of that veil. 5 minutes after you die, you'll know. You'll have seen and experienced. You will have the foretaste of your destiny for all eternity. And those 5 minutes really are coming for all of us. Whatever lies beyond them, they're inevitable. They'll happen for every one of us. That's the reality. So think about the sights you'll see, the voices you'll hear again, the experiences you will have. C.S. Lewis was a great writer, professor. He was also a man of great faith. And he was asked one time at a seminar at Oxford, he was asked what he knew about the afterlife, life beyond. And he didn't hesitate to answer. He cheerfully grinned and smiled and said, "Guesses, only guesses. But if they're not true, something better will be." Later, as some of you know, he wrote the Chronicles of Narnia. And at the end, Lewis describes what the children of this story experience after they die. Listen to this. There's a whole series, Chronicles of Narnia. There's four or five, how many, Steph? Six, seven. The literate Jameses are down here. Seven Chronicles of Narnia. This is the very end. He's written the whole series. The children have gone through adventures. But then at the very end of the seventh, they die. They're in a car, train, crash. The children die. But listen how it ends. All their life in this world had only been the cover and the title page. Now, at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before. Wow. What do you think about when you hear that? And when you ponder it a little bit? Anticipation? Excitement? Hope? Or maybe a little anxiety, uncertainty, even fear. It's such a mystery, isn't it? The unknown. We could be afraid. Winston Churchill, near the end of his life, he was way up in his 80s. He had a series of little strokes. And he wrote a friend. And here's what he described his situation. He said, "My life is like an airplane at the end of a long flight at dusk, running low on petrol. searching for a safe place to land. Vintage Churchill, but also quintessentially human. How much better it is if we know there is a safe place to land. Well, listen, Paul just read it. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. And I go and prepare a place for you." I almost want to sing hallelujah. There is the promise that we'll be safe, Ruthie, all those we've loved and lost a little while, and Jesus will be with us and we'll be at home. Nancy said it too. If we have that mindset, that understanding, then we can go toward death with confidence and, I want to say, even with a sense of humor and with an unshakable grit. Tell you one more story. Decades ago, I was doing some grad work down in the States, and this story comes from one of the profs there. It's a true story, but you're going to have to use your imagination. As I describe this, you're going to have to use your imagination to understand and get it. My prof told us about a young woman who was teaching at the university there. She taught human kinetics, phys ed. She was a marvelous person, young, vigorous. And one night she was sitting in her apartment grading papers, and a knock came on the door. She went to the door and opened it, and there stood Death with a yellow face. She slammed the door and locked it and called the doctor. And he said, "Malignant." She had surgery. And then a few months later, she was back at school, and everyone said, "Hey, you're looking good." And she said, "I never felt better." She lost a little bit of weight, but she was back teaching and bouncing on trampolines, all of that, doing great. Everything seemed to be wonderful. And one night she was at home watching television. She heard a knock at the door. She went, opened the door, and there he stood with his yellow face. She slammed it and locked it and called the doctor. And he said, "Chemotherapy." Oh, she was sick. She lost all her hair, came out. She got a wig, beautiful, good wig. And when she got back to the school, people told her, "That looks good on you. You should have been wearing that all the while." She said, "I feel pretty good." And she was back teaching again. And one night she was sitting there grading papers in her room, and she heard a knock. So she went to the door and unlocked it. And there he stood, old Death, with his yellow face. She slammed the doors, tried to lock it. The lock was broken. She called her friends and relatives, and they came. Everybody gathered. They leaned against the door. They took turns holding it back. They leaned against that door. They even got to where they were laughing and joking about it. "We're not going to let him in. We're keeping him out." And they'd look out the window, and she would look out the window, and old Death would be sitting there under the tree with his yellow face. Then one night she said to them all, "Move away from the door." "What?" "Move away." And so they moved away from the door, and he came in. And the prof who told us, he said, "I felt sorry for him. Old Death likes to think he brings darts of pain and fear, but there he stood, and in one hand he had peace, and in the other hand he had rest, and he looked like a servant of God." And so he is. Death, for people of faith, is God's servant. coming to lead us into a new adventure, which goes on forever, and which every chapter is better than the one before. So I'm going back to what Nance said about Ruthie being home. And I want that for all of us. When we think out ahead for you, for those you love, I want you to be able to walk out of here confident and assured and say, Lord, I'm ready whenever you call me, but put a light in the window. Have some old friends and loved ones there to greet me. And cares all past. Home at last. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.
My name is Reverend Heather Joy James. Ruth and I held one another in prayer often. I would often message her and ask, would you pray for me about this, that, or the other thing? And it got to be that sometimes I wouldn't even ask. I knew she was already praying. In that way, it doesn't feel like she's gone, because across time zones and geographical distance, I felt buoyed by those sense of prayers. If you are in this room or watching online, I can guarantee you Ruth prayed for you personally by name more than once. She prayed, a Lord have mercy over you. She prayed an, oh God, help them, in a whisper. She prayed a blessing over your life, just because. I want to just invite you to look around and see all of those prayers rolled up in a life. Jesus said, if you have seen him, then you have seen the Father. And those who follow Jesus seek to embody more of Christ's qualities, become Christ-like. We try. Here's what I think is true. As we experience more of God, we reflect more of God. And those who look at us see different aspects of God and experience God. So again, I want to invite you to think of Ruth and the ways and the places that you saw God, because those are reflections of where she met God in her life. Here's what I think Ruth knew. In the fires of life, we are not alone. There is another one in the fire standing there with us, holding our hand, seeing us truly for who we are in our pain. So I tell you all that to invite you to pray with me. I want to invite you to just take your right hand and place it on your right knee or your right thigh. And then take your left hand. This one's yours, your right hand. It's easier if you're seated. Take your left hand. This is Jesus' hand. Just place it right over your own. Imagining the hand of Jesus, feeling that right there with you, the hand of our Lord, right on top of your hand. And let us pray. Holy and wondrous God, we are gathered here today, beloved of one another, and beloved of Ruth. We are heartbroken that the world will not have more days, more hours, more years of Ruth. And we grieve together. We are all at a loss. But God, you show us the way when we feel there is no way. God, we don't know how to do this, but you do. You know our hearts. You know our needs. God, be with us and hold us close. And so we pray in thanksgiving for Ruth Bethany James, for the love she gave and the love she received, for the sparkle, the wit, the charm, and the sarcasm. We thank you for the soft place to land and the strong shoulder to cry on that she was, for her kindness. Oh God, for her kindness. Thank you. Teach us, oh God, to look for your hand of mercy. Teach us to sit together and hold one another's hand. Teach us to look for those who need someone to sit. Teach us to get close and to hold their hand as you would. For the grace and mercy that none of us will read every book, but for those who love literacy, we will try. Lord, have mercy. Oh God, in dark nights of the soul, when our souls suffer in silence, remind us you are with us, and when we need it, hold back the seas. When the fires rage and we feel as though we are about to go up in smoke, remind us you stand with us. Holy and divine comforting presence, we thank you that Ruth experienced so deeply, that you, Lord Jesus, sit with us, and that you bring us unimaginable strength, forgiveness, compassion, joy. Oh God, we thank you that prayer and communion with you is an intimate experience, and we thank you that we are not passive observers here in this life. We are gathered here today in your church as the body of Christ to be your hands and feet to one another. And so we can say with confidence, Amen. Praise the Lord and Amen. Because we thank you, God, for Ruth. We love her and we trust her to you. And may you hold her precious until we meet again. Amen.
Thank you, Heather Joy. We have one last song to sing together before Ruth Daddy brings our benediction. So would you stand with us and let's put our trust where Ruth put hers, in Christ alone.
Scorned by the ones There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me.
Commands Ruth's destiny. No power of man, no scheme of man can ever part me from his hand. To me returns and calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever part me from his hand. When he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ will stand.
Going to let you know the last words that I spoke to Ruth at Dravinsky ICU was a benediction, not the one I usually use, but this is what came into my mind, and let this be a benediction today for all of us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace this day and always. Amen.
Before you go anywhere, we hope you will stick around for a little bit afterwards. Some light refreshments in our little courtyard out here. Some wonderful folks from the St. Andrews community have prepared those for us. And some words of instruction. We would ask, please, that you keep your masks on until you are outside, and that as you come out through this way here, never did get any bigger, did it, John? But as you slide through this door here, there is a table. Actually, Nordine Miller is going to be out there, and she's going to give you a glove to put on, whatever hand you would serve your food with. We want to keep in mind some COVID precautions still. So put a glove on, serve yourself, and then once you've exited through the hospitality room to outside, you can be done with your mask and your glove. So would you just... Oh, yes, and the jewelry? Yes, yeah, and then you may want to sit down after Grace, so have a seat. Well, I don't know if you may jump back up again after Grace, and you'll see why in a minute. So would you say Grace with me for just a moment? We'll give thanks for the food. God, we give thanks for the life of dear sweet Ruth, and we give you thanks for community that gathers around. That in the words of another pastor, you give us back to one another in resurrection. And so we come together and we share a little bit of life. We will share stories We will share all the funny and we will share all the love. Please bless the time that we have together yet. And please bless Ruth on this one last road trip.